Thank you, ladies. Appreciate it. Today's message. Does that sound clear? Today's message was hard for me when I put it together. It's called Caught in the Spin Cycle of Sin. It's that sin that we do over and over and over again, expecting the same, a different result. And it, we're going to look at David in the book. But it's just a something to think about. It's a road to maturity in Christ. So without further ado, I'm going to go right into the message. Lord, be with us today, Lord. Let this message come directly from you through my heart to the people on the floor today, Lord. Lord, I can't do anything without you. It all has to be from you. Lord, let this message touch someone's heart. Let's start with me. Lord, thank you for all the opportunities you give us. And be blessed in your precious, precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Albert Einstein once said, "Insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result." He was, of course, talking about science, but what if we applied it to life? What in your life have you repeated over and over again and expected a different result? It was a question that I asked myself over and over again with a follow-up question to this. What is it that you are looking for? We are creatures of habit by nature, and we can quickly establish patterns in our lives. Sometimes they are healthy, and sometimes they are not. And before we know it, we can be caught in a vicious cycle of repeated behaviors. And it can be hard to break. At times it feels like it is downright impossible. And we move through the cycle of action to guilt, to promise not to do it again, to doing it again. Have you ever been caught in the cycle of sin? One more swig, just one more hit, one more drag, just one more look on the internet. It's just a few dollars that no one will ever know it's missing. It's just a simple shopping trip. It's the cycle. And before we know it, we are caught in the cycle of insanity brought on by sin. We repeat things over and over again, hoping for, longing for, and even expecting a different result. But how do we break that cycle? I want to fill this question through our story today as we identify a principal truth, and that is sin will function at its highest efficiency when it operates in isolation and secrecy. Amen.
Amen.
If you have your Bibles, let's look at 2 Samuel chapter 11, 1 through 17. You got to say amen.
Amen.
It says, "In the spring, at the time when kings go off to war, David sent Joab out with the king's men and the whole Israeli army. They destroyed the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah, but David remained in Jerusalem. One evening, David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman bathing, and the woman was very beautiful. And David sent someone to find out about her. The man said, 'Isn't this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, and the wife of Uriah the Hittite?' Then David sent messengers to get her. She came to him, and she slept with her. Then she went back home. The woman conceived and sent word to David saying, 'I am pregnant.' So David sent this word to Joab, 'Send me Uriah the Hittite.' And Joab sent him to David. When Eliab came to him, David asked him how Joab was, how the soldiers were, and how the war was going on. Then David said to Uriah, "Go down to your house and wash your feet." So Uriah left the palace, and a gift from the king was sent after him. But Uriah slept at the entrance of the palace with all the master's servants and did not go down to the house. When David was told Uriah did not go home, he asked him, "Haven't you just come from a distance? Why don't you go home?" Uriah said to David, "The ark and Israel and Judah are staying in tents, and my master Joab and my lord's men are camped in open fields. How could I go to my house and eat and drink and lie with my wife? As surely as you live, I will not do such a thing." Then David said to him, "Stay here one more day, and tomorrow I will send you back." So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day and the next. At David's invitation, he ate and drank with him, and David made him drunk. But in the evening, Uriah went out to sleep on his mat among his master's servants. He did not go home. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it with Uriah. In it he wrote, "Put Uriah on the front line where the fighting is fiercest, and withdraw from him, so he will be struck down and die." So while Joab had the city under siege, he put Uriah at the place where he knew the strongest defenders were. When the men of the city came out and fought against Joab, some of the men in David's army fell. Moreover, Uriah the Hittite died. Today's passage is the story of a man named David. He was the king of Israel during her golden age. And while scriptures tell us that David was a man after God's own heart, David also was prone to huge lapses in judgment. And so, at the time when kings would normally go out to war, David stays in Jerusalem. He remains safe and secure. He does not go out with his men to fight. Instead, he remains at home alone, where idle hands end up being the devil's playground. After waking up, from an afternoon nap, he takes a stroll in the cool breeze afforded on the palace roof and looks over the city. And he sees a woman who is taking a bath on the roof of an adjacent house. It may seem odd to us, but this would have been a normal practice in David's time. There were no hot water heaters. Tubs were placed on roofs of homes to let the sun warm the water, and that's where the woman was. David sees her exposed and admires her extraordinary beauty. He is so intrigued that he risks an inquiry about her. "Who is this woman?" he asks. He receives word back that this woman is named Bathsheba, daughter of Elam, and wife of Uriah the Hittite. I love that response. In it, Bathsheba is more than just an object of David's desire. She has a daddy, and she has a husband. David had objectified Bathsheba, making her an object of his desire when he asked about her. Moreover, this woman is married to a man who serves in David's army. Now, the honorable man would leave the situation alone. If David had stopped, the cycle would have stopped. But David does not, and the spin cycle of sin continues. He sends a message that he wants to see this woman, and one thing leads to another. He sleeps with her. The word comes back that Bathsheba is pregnant. This is troubling news. You see, if we look at this in historical context, it is more than a political scandal for David to overcome. Old Testament law, David and Bathsheba could have been taken out of the city and stoned to death. And they, along with the child, would die. Remember our principle. Since sin, at its highest efficiency, when it operates in isolation and secrecy, David attempts to cover up his sin. He wants to keep it a secret. And by doing so, he wants us to limit the damage that it can cause. He deceives He devises an intimate action plan. He brings Uriah back from the battle in hopes that he would spend a little quality time with his wife. So he invites Uriah from the field of battle and sends him home to Bathsheba. You know what David is doing, right? Mm-hmm. He hopes that he can make the claim that the child isn't his own. But plan A flops. Uriah will not even go to his wife or even his own house while the other men and the Ark of the Covenant are on the field of battle. So David goes with plan B, and plan B is much more sinister. David sends a message to his general Joab. Uriah is to be placed in the front lines of the battle, where the fighting is the worst. And then Israel is to withdraw from the battle, leaving Uriah isolated. Uriah is set up to be killed in battle. And plan B works. Once Uriah is eliminated from the picture, David quickly takes Bathsheba to be one of his wives. It's sin in isolation and secrecy. While there would certainly be rumors about the length of the marriage before the baby was born, the situation was still manageable. David could spin that. It could not be positively proven that the child was conceived out of wedlock. Do you see the cycle of sin? Sin likes to spin the truth to meet the situation. Let me say that again. Sin likes to spin the truth to meet the situation. Amen. When we get caught in this spin cycle, we believe that, number one, I can manage sin better by covering it up. We try to cover it up, manage it on our own. We do not want the sin to be discovered, so we hide it. We cover it. It's a temptation. Sin functions at its highest efficiency when it operates in isolation and secrecy. So shame will drive sin to seek cover. But the reality is this. Sin that is covered up and self-managed will quickly grow. I like C.S. Lewis' books, The Chronicles of Narnia. I especially like The Voyage of the Dawn Treader. In this book, we are introduced to Eustace. He is a little precocious and self-absorbed, so when he and his cousins are magically transported into the middle of the sea in the world of Narnia, Eustace is not pleased. They end up being rescued by Prince Caspian, who is sailing the ship the Dawn Treader to uncover the mystery of the missing kings. As the story progresses, the ship's crew stops at a mysterious island to find supplies for the journey. Eustace, being Eustace, wanders off from the campsite to avoid helping. He wanders the island alone when he catches a glint of the sun of something shining. He sees a cave. And when he explores, he stumbles onto the cave filled with treasure, gold coins and silver goblets rimmed with precious jewels. And Eustace is yelling, "I'm rich!" He immediately determines that the treasure he has found is his and his alone. He found it first. What he does not realize is that the treasure is cursed. Anyone who takes from it is doomed to a magical transformation. He awakes in the cave the next morning and is frightened by the sound of a dragon breathing. He flees from the cave back toward the camp, but when he gets back, his cousins and the crew of the ship do not recognize him because he is the dragon. And everyone flees. Eustace is alone. The story goes on to tell how he sits down in front of a pond and stares at his reflection in the water. And he begins to reason that there is still a little boy under all those scales. If only they could be removed, like sin that covers. So he digs his dragon claws under the scales as deep as he dares and peels the skin back. Oh, it hurts terribly. When he can stand the pain no longer, he looks at his progress. He is still a dragon, even bigger than before. The more he tore away, on his own, the more the cycle grew. Freedom from the cycle cannot come through individual effort alone. Why? Because the cycle of sin functions at its highest efficiency when it operates alone. We do not have the power ourselves to defeat it. Try as we might, the scales of sin resist our futile efforts. We will remain a growing dragon. Amen?
Amen.
In our text, David thought he had his sin managed and covered, but instead it had grown to become something hideous. His adultery led to deceit, manipulation of men, and murder. Every effort to cover it, to protect himself, led him further and further away from the truth. David believed the spin of sin and got caught up in the cycle. The spin. If I can cover my sin, I can limit the scope of damage. Sin is never a private matter. It will always have an impact on the other people emotionally, physically, and even spiritually. The consequences of David's sin involve willing participants, Bathsheba and Joab, and unwilling participants, Uriah, and the other men who were killed in battle, and the families of those men who were killed. David's sin grew, and the impact spread to people not even involved in the sin. It's the way the cycle works. If you have been caught in the cycle, you know it. We see it even in today's society. Someone who drinks and drives will eventually injure, cripple, or kill someone who doesn't. Someone who looks at pornography will see the intimacy of relationships crumble with his or her spouse and children. The reality is this: sin that is hidden will always have a greater impact than we can imagine. There is one other spin that we might put on the cycle of sin. No one has to know. But if we go back to our text, in the last sentence of 2 Samuel 11 tells us this, 2 Samuel 11, 27, But the thing David had done displeased the Lord. When we think we have covered it up, when we think we have limited the scope of the damage, when we think we have gotten away with it and buried it, the truth is, God already knows. Sin cannot be hidden from God. We want to hide it, but when we do, we get sucked into a vicious growing cycle. The more private the setting of sin, the more addicting it becomes. Remember the principle: sin operates at its best efficiency when it operates in isolation and secrecy. So, do we have to live in the cycle, or is there a way out? Let's look at the rest of the text. God sends a prophet named Nathan to King David, and Nathan shares his story. Turn to 2 Samuel 12, 1 through 7. You gotta say amen. The Lord sent Nathan to David. When he came to him, he said, "There were two men in a certain town, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had a very large number of sheep and cattle, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb he had bought. He had raised it, and it grew up with him and his children. It shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle and to prepare a meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the ewe lamb that belonged to the poor man and prepared it for the one who had come to him." David burned with anger against the man and said to Nathan, "As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this deserves to die. He must pay for the lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity." Then Nathan said to David, "You are the man. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I anointed you king over Israel and delivered you from the hand of Saul." Nathan exposes David's sin to the light. He makes David personally accountable for his actions. "You are that man." This is probably the most important step, because it has to be the first step in order to break out of the cycle before healing can ever take place. We must expose the sin to light. We have to stop trying to hide our sin. Sin operates at its highest efficiency when it operates in isolation and secrecy. And the first step is often the most difficult, because sin hates to be exposed. Amen. If we look at John 3:19-21, you got it. Say amen. Amen. Jesus said, "This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men love the darkness instead of the light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for the fear that his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what he has done has been done through God." Amen. If we have sin in our lives, it must be exposed to the truth. Without step one, exposing the sin to the light, we cannot begin to break the cycle of insanity, repeating the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result. In 2 Samuel 12:7-8, "Then Nathan said to David, 'You are that man. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I anointed you king of Israel and delivered you out of the hand of Saul. I gave your master's house to you and your master's wives into your arms. I gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if all this had been too little, I would have given you more.'" That brings us to action step two. We intentionally look to God's blessings in our lives. Sin will look at what we don't have, but God wants us to see what we do have. God directs David's focus on what he has been given. Do you see the blessings given David? Safety from Saul, wives, a palace. God is a generous God. Do you see the blessings in your own life? If you are caught in the cycle, list the blessings that God has given you and thank him for them. When sin comes knocking, break out the list of blessings from God. I think by listing blessings, you will discover the answer to the question, what are you looking for? These two steps will change our perspective. We won't be able to sin and enjoy it as much as we used to. We will see sin for what it really is. Sin. Call sin what it really is. Sin. In 2 Samuel 12:9, "Why did you despise the word of the Lord by doing what is evil in his eyes? You struck down Uriah the Hittite with a sword and took his wife to be your own. You killed him with the sword of the Ammonites." Church, God doesn't pull any punches. You, David, are a murderer. You stole someone else's wife to be your own. What you did was horrific and terrible. And church, we all often like to soften the edges. We like to blunt the blow. But God, through Nathan labels sin as sin. Folks, it is not an affair. It is adultery. Men, it's not enjoying some eye candy. It's full-blown lust that objectifies women. It's not having a few too many drinks. It's drunkenness. It's not borrowing. It's stealing. And it's hideous and evil. And it brings terrible consequences. It did for David. 2 Samuel 12, 10 through 12. You want to turn there? Now, therefore, the sword will never depart from your house, because you despise me and took the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your own. This is what the Lord says. Out of your own household I am going to bring calamity upon you. Before your very eyes I will take your wives and give them to one who is close to you. And he will lie with your wives in broad daylight. You did it in secret, but I will do this thing in broad daylight before all Israel. We see sin for its deadly consequences. It no longer can hold value because it is a temporary fix or high. It's deadly and brings deadly consequences. We know that when we sin, our sin affects us. Hangovers, red eye, calls from creditors. But did you know that when we sin, it also affects God himself? We sin against him. We mar his glory. Sin is never private. It wants us to believe that, because sin functions at its highest efficiency when it operates in isolation and secrecy. So we have to expose our sin to the light, remove its efficiency. We have to take off those rose-colored glasses and call sin what it really is, sin. It's ugly and hideous, like a dragon. And we, like Eustace, are powerless to overcome its effects on our own. So listen to God's heart. In closing, when David confesses his sins as sin, when he exposes it to the light, when David sees the consequences of his actions, in 2 Samuel 12, 13 tells us, Nathan replied, "The Lord has taken away your sin. You are not going to die." When David confessed the sin, the consequences were immediately removed. Do you remember Houston? The dragon boy? After trying to break out of the cycle of insanity himself, he fails. He lies down and weeps bitter tears. His fear is that he will be a hideous dragon forever. Through blurry eyes, he sees a great lion approaching. Aslan shows up. For those not familiar with the story, Aslan is the Christ figure. And Aslan asks Eustace if he wants to be a boy again. Eustace is hopeless, and he pleads to Aslan, "Yes, please, free me from this skin." He warns the boy that the process could be painful. But Eustace is desperate, so Aslan flicks out his claws and carefully digs into Eustace's dragon flesh. Aslan digs deeper and further and longer than Eustace had dared to do himself. Eustace's heart pounds wildly in his chest as Aslan tears away the scales and digs into the dragon flesh. Eustace would later in the book describe the pain as immense and good, all wrapped up together, like removing a splinter. When Aslan is finished, Eustace looks reluctantly at his reflection in the pond again. And what image appears? It's the image of a boy. Church, it is the renewing that Jesus Christ wants to accomplish in us. You see, Jesus went all the way to the cross for us. He died for our sins. And with the blood of Jesus, with his help and him aside us and with us, not us on our own, but with him standing and firmly in prayer and being with him and walking with him, he can take it away. We're not perfect. We are going to fall. But we need to break from that cycle. We need to break that sin that keeps popping and popping and popping up over and over again. By repenting, which means to turn away from, that Jesus has paid that price. Amen. So today, I ask you, are you ready? Are you ready to break that cycle? Let's pray. Dear Father God, I ask you today to cleanse us of all our sins and to help us break the cycle through the power of your Son, Jesus. Through the power of his blood, which is spilled out on the cross, let it cover us today from the tops of our heads to the soles of our feet. And may we be transformed. Yes, God, may we be transformed to walk into the glory of his light and never in the darkness of our sins. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. Lord, I'd like to pray for the offering. Lord, as we come to give our first fruits, let us be cheerful givers. For it is all for the glory of your kingdom that we may help spread the good news throughout the world. We love you, God. And it is in Jesus' almighty name. Amen. Amen.